Just catch the news. Radio, television, newspaper, or internet. You'll get a consistently gloomy outlook. Switch to Christian media, and it is just as bad, maybe worse. The church's perspective hasn't always been so pessimistic. In the late 1800s into the early 20th century, there was a popular teaching that the world would get better and better until Jesus returns. All that effectively ended with World War I. Or did it? Welcome to Wait Till You Hear This. I'm Steve Eastman.
Under divine inspiration, Solomon declared, "Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a dream fulfilled is a tree of life." He reminded those who want to triumph that hopelessness is not an option. This life is much more than misery and despair. God hasn't forgotten us or left us to our own devices. His goodness and love are transforming the cosmos.
That was J.D. King, reading from the introduction to his groundbreaking book, Why You've Been Duped Into Believing That the World Is Getting Worse. J.D., thanks for visiting us today on Wait Till You Hear This.
Thank you. So glad to be here with you, Steve.
J.D. is one of the pastors of World Revival Church, which was birthed from the Smithton Outpouring of 1996. The ministry is now located in Kansas City. J.D., one of the things that I appreciate about your book is that it bases its assertions on solid statistics. Why is this so at odds with what the news media is telling us?
The actual facts, you know, details, numbers actually tell a good story about the world. And, you know, sometimes the news media actually makes their money by making us believe that things are actually pretty bad. Kind of hard to pay attention to just good news. People want to, they're drawn into disaster and trouble. And so in order to make money, they like to scare us.
Well, let's make one thing clear. You are not saying that the world is all puppy dogs and butterflies, right?
No, not at all.
Well, what do you say? How about if we dig into some of your subject matter? World War I ended optimism for a generation, followed a couple decades or so later by World War II. Excuse me for playing the devil's advocate, but shouldn't we be expecting more and more war?
There was a lot of war in the centuries leading up to World War I and II. Those were very violent eras. Anthropologists and others have suggested, though, that maybe as much as 15% of the population would have been killed in some of the older conflicts. There certainly was the idea that things are going to continue to grow in that manner, but since the end of World War II, violence has dropped exponentially worldwide. The kind of violent deaths in war and conflict that we saw up to that time is virtually non-existent.
Wow. That's amazing. It seems like wherever we go, we hear about the coronavirus. It's almost unavoidable. How does this disease stack up against the plagues of the past?
Whether it be the Black Plague in Europe or, you know, a lot of the other pandemics, even the Spanish flu from about 100 years ago, these other plagues were much more destructive, damaging. Deaths were unimaginable. One-third of Europe died from the Black Plague. That's hard to imagine ever, you know, disease on that level. And, you know, again, I don't want to in any way diminish the concerns people might have the coronavirus, but again, you're looking at 3% or less of those actually inflicted with the disease, probably more like 1% are actually dying. But the Black Plague actually literally killed one-third of Europe. So, for example, if the United States has 300 million people, that would mean 100 million people died. That's what happened during the latter Middle Ages there.
So do you think the reaction to the virus is overblown a bit?
Well, these are complicated questions in that I do think there are unique things in this particular disease that, you know, it's going to require, you know, just some wisdom of application. But with that said, I do think the news media always overblows problems. I think in their mind, it's for a greater good. You know, if we get people extra scared, they might, you know, make some healthy decisions. I'm on the fence sometimes on this particular issue because this particular disease doesn't have vaccines and all yet, and it requires a little bit of extra care. But, you know, the news media is definitely going to blow it out of proportion like they always do.
Okay, well, how about if we pick another couple of issues out of the headlines? Racial discrimination and violence against women. Any cause for optimism here?
I certainly have found the facts to suggest that. Go back into the late 1800s, early 20th century, there was just terrible things done against the African-American people, for example. There were hangings and all kinds of terrible action. Tens of thousands of people actually part of the Ku Klux Klan. Fortunately, today, you don't find that nearly at all. The statistics are going down. FBI and all has confirmed that actual racially motivated violence is the lowest it's been perhaps ever. And same way it goes for women. I mean, you know, certainly women have been treated poorly, but you got to imagine it was just 100 years ago they got a right to vote. It was not until the 60s and 70s that a lot of women were allowed in certain colleges, you know, being able to have a credit card. Women are treated the best they've ever been treated ever in the history of the world, globally. Obviously, there's always some things that need to continue to improve, but if we're going to talk about a worldwide story, the story of how women are treated is much better than it's ever been.
Well, we can understand how the news media profits from the if it bleeds, it leads kind of philosophy. You've mentioned that. And this is often driven by political motivations. With Christians, it should be different. True, we still need to know what's going on so we can respond and pray effectively. But we also need to thank God for the progress that He's given us.
There's many, many things moving in the right direction. Abortions are lessening. People are living much longer. Diseases, contrary to what it might feel like today, are much less evident. People are getting cancer on average 10 years later than they used to. It's good news on almost every front.
I grew up watching Leave It to Beaver, J.D.
I watched the reruns, but I watched them.
And America seems to be a different country today where long-honored Judeo-Christian traditions have been ground into the dirt. Many churches are so politically correct that they barely give God lip service. If you will, tie this together with your idea of the changing center of Christianity.
I am saying as a whole, globally, the world is getting better. And my thesis is it's because of Christianity. But I think we can all agree that there are patterns and trends in the United States that we don't prefer. Things that lean away from faith and hope and truth of Jesus. But with that said, God is at work in the world. As you're alluding to, the center of Christianity is no longer Europe or the United States. It would be Africa or maybe China or perhaps even Latin America. The shift is toward what they call the global south, away from the West, and there's exponential Christian growth in those places, great revivals, hundreds of thousands of people coming to Jesus. We talk about how family values are eroding in, for example, the United States, which there's a degree of truth to that. But if you were to look, say, in Latin America now, you would find some of the revivals are causing men that were addicted to drugs or alcoholics to actually turn back toward their family. One could argue there's objective family values emerging in these places.
And what is the outlook for the U.S. and Europe? Can we expect some improvement?
Well, I certainly believe so on a variety of levels. I think it's more fair to say that the United States and Europe have stagnated than they've utterly fallen apart. There are a lot of pockets of beautiful things happening in both places. Interestingly enough, missionaries from the global south, people from Africa and Asia, you know, Latin America are actually planting churches in, you know, the UK as well as the United States. And many of these churches are growing.
Wow. I wish we could get more of these stories. And I know our listeners would like to learn more, too. How can they get a copy of Why You've Been Duped into Believing That the World is Getting Worse?
Obviously, it is available on Amazon.com, but you could also get it directly from me through my shop. It's called the ResurgenceStore.com. Again, the ResurgenceStore.com, and it has my book and some other resources that people might be interested in.
And J.D., I look long and hard to find stories with a positive spin to counterbalance all the negatives. You've made my day just by talking about this. Thanks for spending a few minutes with us.
You bet. I'm glad to be able to talk to you, Steve.
J.D. King is the author of Why You've Been Duped into Believing That the World is Getting Worse. You can visit his website at authorjdking.com. This is Steve Eastman for Wait Till You Hear This.
Discover more stories like this one on our website, waittillyouhearthis.com.